It gives me great pleasure to spend a few minutes with you today to talk a little bit more around central dizziness, and in particular central dizziness in the assessment of eye movements in videonystagmography that enables us to be maybe a little bit more sensitive to some of the central nervous system changes that we may see in some dizzy patients. Often when we're considering what options we have to examine central changes in VNG, the question comes of why we may be interested in looking at that when often traditionally we're considering whether there is a peripheral vestibular involvement. And really the prevalence and epidemiological studies that have looked at dizziness and the presenting of dizziness within patients shows that about 25% of those putting themselves forward for specialist assessment may have some central nervous system involvement, if that isn't not only their unique feature in their symptom set. So it becomes quite important to be able to examine those patients and have tools available to quantify some changes that may be occurring to enable the successful identification, management, and treatment of those conditions. Obviously, in the last decades, we have seen brain imaging and accessibility to brain imaging becoming much more readily available. And brain scans give a great deal of information around localizing, certainly cerebrally focused pathological changes. However, from a scientific point of view, what brain scans don't really give us a great deal of information about is the functional impact that any of those pathological changes, whether that's an injury through trauma, through neurodegenerative disease, or some other acute lesion that's actually affecting the patient. Often the first time when we start to look at differentiating between central and peripheral dizziness is really when we see dizziness being presented into the emergency room. And we've had a lot of recent publications over the last decade by Newman Talker et al. And other groups, Kim and Lee, looking at the prevalence of central dizziness, particularly in this acute setting. And certainly the HINTS protocol, looking at eye movements and nystagmus behavior in differentiating between peripheral and central dizziness, has been widely reported. So considering how we can move the HINTS protocol to some greater degree of sensitivity in differentiating these central changes relative to peripheral acute changes, if we break that down into the head impulse test, and here we can see a video head impulse test being added into here, looking for nystagmus and nystagmus behavior, here we can see a VNG option to examine that and quantify it, and test of skew. So really, when we're looking at these examinations, we can increase the sensitivity by making much more quantifiable measurement of eye movement behavior, whether that is differentiating between peripheral semicircular canal function and central function, or even looking at spontaneous nystagmus, or moving between an oculomotor screening exam on VHIT and moving into a much more detailed oculomotor exam in VNG. Having the access to technology enables us to differentiate between these two conditions and two presentations of dizziness much more readily. Staying with eye movement examination, really this is where the generation of videonystagmography has shown successive improvements. And why might we want to be still interested in eye movements whilst we have MRI imaging to look for central nervous system pathology? Well, as we said before, the advent of MRI certainly has been much more readily available over the recent decades. However, we've also argued that functional change doesn't really get strongly represented within imaging. And also actually the sensitivity of separating out some of the movement, eye movement disorders that we can see under VNG is not always as easy to see under MRI. So we may look at things of isolated dysfunctions, for example, of a horizontal saccade being a Pons lesion, or some isolated lesions of the vertical saccade production being located to the midbrain. So eye movements are very sensitive at giving us good access to the human physiological function covering the majority of the brain. What do we need to do then in VNG to enable us to look at things in a little bit more detail? If we're already looking at oculomotor tests in our traditional VNG, looking at random saccades, smooth pursuit, and gaze holding, well, really that moves us more towards an advanced oculomotor assessment, using both pro and anti-saccade assessments to quantify eye movement behavior over a different ranges of both time and duration and velocity. This gives us greater sensitivity, looking at neurological changes such as central disorders, neurodegenerative diseases, right through to movement disorders, traumatic brain injury, and other neurologically focused pathologies. So within a Pro-saccade graph, what we're seeing is some very similar measurements initially, looking at both the latency, velocity, and accuracy of those eye movements moving towards the target as it changes in position. However, the summary data is much more detailed, and what we can see here for the Pro-saccades is we have information in relation to the eye position, the velocity behaviour of the eye right and leftward, the latency distributions relative to eye position in the time base, and also the acceleration and deceleration of the eye as it changes in position. And finally, the directional error rate. This becomes much more interesting when we're looking at anti-saccade behavior. So here we can see some anti-saccades, and really what that represents is a suppression of the desire to use a refixation saccade to track the target as it moves in position, to move the eye opposite to that target position. So if the target moves to the right, we move the eye to the left and repeat. So this includes some higher brain function to actually suppress those particular reflexes. The analysis of the error or latency and distribution of latency of anti-saccades gives a greater indication of the function of the frontal lobes and the frontal eye fields. And again, directional error rates, because this has an executive brain function, can uncover some central nervous system changes that may be not clear in any of the other subtle signs that we see in the oculomotor exam. So let's bring that together as a case study. So here we have a male born October 63, presenting with a detailed history, but summarized here with dizziness on head turns. VNG has been normal and has ruled out any peripheral vestibular dysfunction, so we're not looking at any asymmetry between the peripheral systems. And the idea is that maybe this is an early sign of multiple sclerosis. In the presence of a normal VNG and normal saccades, one would think that there isn't anything central that's jumping out in this particular scenario. What we can see are the latency distributions, median values being very symmetric and within the normal range, and the same can be said for the velocity distribution and accuracy also. However, moving into the advanced oculomotor assessment through saccadometry, again looking at the Pro-saccades, what we can see is the velocity distributions are, whilst on face value looking symmetric, if we take a little look at a bit more detail, what we can see is some of those velocity values are falling into the abnormal range. That changes depending on the position of the target. Again, if we look at the accuracy, whilst the median values are symmetric, we can see with leftward movements, we've got inaccurate saccades being present. When we move this examination into the anti-saccades, the more complex assessment of oculomotor function, we can see the latency distributions over the time base both being delayed but unequal between right and leftward movements. This can also be seen in the phase, with rightward movements representing the left hemisphere being tightly bundled, but leftward movements representing the right hemisphere showing poor correlation of eye velocity in different positions, often referred to as a spaghetti-like appearance. Also, the detection error rate is greater than 7%, so that gives us a good red flag for central nervous system changes. So we can see with this particular case, the application of saccadometry, particularly moving from pro to anti-saccade assessment, gives a greater insight into the abnormal brain function that wasn't really uncovered in the routine screening through random saccades.